Good morning, church. Good morning. It's good to see you. Hi. Yeah. Whoa. Okay. All right. Oh, it is great to see you this morning. If you didn't know, my name's Tommy Creutz. I'm the new campus pastor here of just a couple weeks ago. And it's very excited to bring God's word to us this morning. If you don't know me, you're going to. but I'm a bit sarcastic. I believe that it's one of my love languages, and unfortunately it frustrates my wife to no end. And everyone knows who is just even a little bit sarcastic that, like, sarcasm 101, like first level sarcasm, is like the air quotes. You guys know what I'm talking about? Right? Like, oh yeah, great job. You know, like that's like the first level of sarcasm. We also know that our children tend to imitate their parents, right? They're a bit like a mirror. not mirroring just the good things either. Sometimes they mirror the bad things that you do. Sometimes they mirror your sarcasm, right? And so that is happening in the Creutz household right now, where our son Zion, who is 7, is picking up on our sarcasm, mine specifically, and specifically the air quotes. And it is both frustrating and hilarious because he does it completely right. Like, you would think it would take some learning to get used to how do you use the air quotes correctly. No, he's nailing it. And this week we were at a conference in Denver, ETS. And while we were there, they were at home, and our daughter Ava, who's 3, she loves to draw. And so she's drawing all of these pictures on the kitchen table. And she's so proud of herself, and we're a pretty positive family. And so she, you know, calls my wife over. She said, Mommy, come and look at my drawing. And Kelly comes over, and she looks at it, and she's like, Ava, this is so good. I can't believe how good this is. It's so good. And she goes, Zion, will you look at this picture that Ava drew? And he looks over, and he goes, yeah, Ava, that's so good. It's really good, Ava. That's such a good drawing. And he kept doing it. And Kelly goes, why are you doing this? Why are you doing air quotes with good? And he goes, because it's not really good. Oh, imitation. We are going to have to fix that one. But this happens all the time in relationships, doesn't it? Imitation. The more time you spend with someone, the more you start to imitate them. Especially we see this in parent-child relationships. And this is also true in our relationship with Jesus as well. When we spend time with Christ, we imitate him. In fact, the New Testament uses this term. It speaks in these terms. It uses this language of imitation quite frequently. 1 Corinthians 11:1, this is the Apostle Paul. He says, imitate me as I imitate Christ. Or in Ephesians 5:1, he says, be imitators of God as beloved children. Jesus' repeated call throughout the Gospels to follow me is actually an invitation to imitate him. And in our passage today, what we're going to be taking a look at Peter. And the past couple of weeks, if you've been joining us in the book of Acts, we've been jumping and seeing different people in the book of Acts. We started with Stephen, and he was persecuted and killed as the first martyr. And then there's this great persecution that happened in Jerusalem, and the Christians fled Jerusalem out into Judea and Samaria and beyond. And then we looked at Philip and his evangelistic efforts as he was traveling around. And then we looked at Saul, who was the one who was ravaging and persecuting the church. And then we saw his incredible conversion to Christ on the road to Damascus, and then him proclaiming Jesus Christ in the synagogues and then escaping all of these plots to kill him. And now we turn our attention to Peter. And what we see in Acts 9:32 through 43 are two descriptive telling of events of what Peter was up to. It's like he went here and he did this and this happened. And then he went there and he did that and that happened. It's very descriptive, much like most of the book of Acts is. And as we're reading through, especially this part in Acts, we're seeing a theme. And the theme that we're seeing is that the kingdom of God is breaking through into the kingdom of this age, or the kingdom of darkness. The kingdom of God is breaking through into the kingdom of darkness. In fact, it's great that we're looking at Peter, because Jesus says to Peter at Caesarea of Philippi, he says, on this rock, Petra, on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. And so think of the kingdom of darkness like a kingdom, like a defensive fortress, right? With defensive fortified gates. And what's happening in the book of Acts is that the kingdom of God is breaking through those gates. It's breaking them down, and it is flowing in and taking ground, pushing through into the kingdom of darkness, into the kingdom of this present age. And so I'm going to try and make an argument today that one of the best ways that we can continue to push into the kingdom of darkness is through multiplication. And the best way to multiply is through imitation. So the title of our time is Multiplication by Imitation, Acts 9, 32 through 43. But I want to jump into verse 31, which was the last verse of last week. It says, so the church throughout all of Judea and Galilee and Samaria had peace and was being built up and walking in the fear of the Lord and in the comfort of the Holy Spirit, it multiplied. I think it's really helpful maybe after that you just write, how? Question mark. And then Luke tells us, how was the church being built up? How was it multiplying? What did that look like? And then it zooms in on this story, the short two stories of Peter. This is how it was multiplying and being built up, multiplication by imitation. Because what we're going to see is that Peter imitated Christ. Much like Stephen a couple of weeks ago or a month ago or whenever that was, Stephen imitated Christ. Peter is doing the same thing. He is imitating Christ. And we're going to take a look at these two stories, and we're actually going to look at them in parallel, meaning we're going to go through them at the same time together, right? So let's start with verse 32. And the first thing that we're going to see is that we go to those who need you. We go to those who need you. Verse 32 says, now Peter, as he went here and there among them all, he came down also to the saints who lived at Lydda. This is west of Jerusalem. He came to those who lived at Lydda. There he found a man named Aeneas, bedridden for 8 years, who was paralyzed. So that's the first part of the first story. And then let's go down to verse 36. This is the first part of the second story. Now there was in Joppa a disciple named Tabitha, which translated means Dorcas. Do we have anyone named Dorcas in here? Tough. It's tough. But she was amazing. Dorcas was amazing. Tough name, amazing woman. She was full of good works and acts of charity. And in those days, she became ill and died. And when they had washed her, they laid her in an upper room. And since Lydda was near Joppa, the disciples, hearing that Peter was there, sent two men to him, urging him, please come to us without delay. So we see Peter going to multiple people in the first parts of these two stories. He goes to the believers who have needs, the saints. He also goes to the sick, Aeneas, who has a need. He goes to with the disciples who have lost someone whom they very much care for. He goes to multiple people, and there's some really important principles that we can pull out of even just this part of the passage. The first thing is that we should build each other up. We should build each other up. It says that Peter is going from here to there among them all in verse 32. What does that mean? Them all. Who is them all? Well, it's believers. It's Christians. It's people who are following the way. It's probably groups of Christians, the start of maybe small churches. Peter is going to them. It says in verse 32 that he goes to the saints who lived in Lydda. And the reason Peter is going around to all of these groups of believers is to teach and to preach as an apostle, which means one who has authority, right? Meaning he is going around and he is building up the church. He's giving them correct doctrine and making sure that they are on mission. He's building and strengthening the church. Because listen, many of these people who are in these areas, they would be new converts, right? They would be new converts to the way. In fact, probably they were evangelized by Philip as he was traveling around the area. And so they were new. And so they needed to be built up in sound doctrine. And so Peter is traveling around in this itinerant preaching ministry doing exactly that. He's building them up in sound doctrine. But you also have believers who have been scattered out of Jerusalem because of the persecution. And because they have been persecuted, they're probably pretty weary, right? They're like, man, I don't know, this is pretty tough. We had to leave our home. And so he's traveling around to all of these groups of believers. He's teaching the new believers sound doctrine, and he is encouraging those who are weary to continue forward, taking ground for the kingdom of God. And this is a first priority for Peter. This is a first priority for him. In fact, all of the other things that are going to happen in these passages is because he was first doing this, going around and building up the church. I think this is so important for us because we all know that we should be looking outside the four walls of our church, right? We know that. We know that outreach is important and that we need to focus on the community around us. We need to get outside of the four walls of our church and serve the people who have physical needs and spiritual needs. We know that. But do we also know that we need to be looking inside the four walls of our church for people who are in need? The people right here in our church who have physical needs, who have spiritual needs. Because listen, in our church here, we have new believers. New believers who need to be built up with strong doctrine. We have people here who've been following Christ for a long time, and maybe it's been a really hard season, and they need some encouragement. They need to be built up and encouraged. Are you coming alongside them? Are you encouraging them? Are you strengthening them? To take it out of the church language for a moment, in my own family, it's really easy for me to be all about the work on the outside, doing the ministry of the church and continuing to pour myself into the church. And I'm seeing all of these needs outside and I'm trying to meet them as best as I can and working and outside. But the reality is my first priority is my first ministry is my family. My wife and my kids, that is my first ministry, and then the ministry of the church comes after that. And sometimes, and my wife is very gracious, I can get so focused on the ministry of the church that I actually neglect my family. I don't give them my very best. I don't give them my first because I'm so focused on something else. And now, I'm not saying that we should not focus on the outside. Don't hear that. We should, and we are, and we're doing great. In fact, we should do more things. We should full steam ahead, doing things outside, but we also, in doing that, we need to add making sure that we are caring for and going to those who are in need in our own family, in our own church family, to prioritize that at the top, building up each other as the church. Amen? Okay, so we build each other up, then we see the need. This is the next principle. We make sure that we see the need. As Peter is going along the way, building up the church, he encounters Aeneas. And then he also encounters the disciples to see him about Tabitha's death. And in those moments, he sees the need. He isn't distracted by the good work that he's doing. He sees the need and he stops what he's doing. He could have said, surely Peter could have said, listen, I'm too busy doing the good work of teaching and preaching. I'm too busy. You know, it's going really well. This is fruitful, me teaching and preaching these things. I don't have time to stop here. He certainly could have said that, right? But he didn't. He stopped and he saw the need of these people who he encountered. How many of us are so busy in life that we barely see the things that are happening around us? Those things that we are busy with might be very good things. Family, our jobs, ministry, right? Good things. But when was the last time that you stopped to see the need of someone outside of your busyness? Honestly, when was the last time that you stopped and saw the need of someone that wasn't in your schedule? We need to be a people, a church with spiritual sight. that sees the needs of others as we are going along the way of our life in ministry, willing to be distracted and disrupted by the Holy Spirit at any moment so that we can see the needs of other people. But not just see the need. The next principle is to meet the need. It's not just seeing the need, it's meeting the needs. And that's what Peter does, is he doesn't just see it, he meets it. He responds, he meets it. He finds this man, Aeneas, who is paralyzed on his mat. And in verse 34, it says, and Peter said to him, "Aeneas, Jesus Christ heals you. Rise and make your bed." And immediately he rose. And after this, many people come to know the Lord in Lydda and in the surrounding areas, multiplication. But then the disciples come and tell him about Tabitha, who had died in a town very close by. And look at verse 39. It says, so Peter rose and went with them. He didn't just see the need, he responded to the need, to meet the need. And maybe Peter was going with these disciples to comfort them, right? Someone had just died, and maybe he was going to be a pastor in that moment and to comfort the disciples who had lost a dear friend. Or maybe he knew in that moment that he was going to heal Dorcas, right? Maybe he knew. We don't know exactly what was going on in Peter's mind, but what we know is that he saw the need and then he went to meet the need. Now, maybe you're not like Peter. Maybe you can't heal people, right? I've tried, I can't do it. But certainly in your circumstance, God has given you gifts. He's given you talents, right? He's given you these things that allow you to meet the needs of others whom you cross paths with. Maybe it's financially, maybe it's with a skill, maybe it's with a home, maybe it's with extra clothes or food, maybe it's with hospitality, maybe it's with encouragement, maybe it's something else. I mean, the list goes on and on, but we have all been given gifts by the Lord. How are we using those gifts to meet the needs of others? To have spiritual sight to see the need and then to meet the need. This is what Jesus did. Peter isn't doing anything new here. He is just imitating Jesus. This is how Jesus operated in the Gospels. If you read through the Gospels, this is what Jesus did. He went around in life and ministry and he saw the needs of people and then he met the needs of people. And he would always, as he was ministering, he would always meet the physical needs of the people he encountered, and then he would meet the spiritual needs of those whom he encountered. Peter is imitating Jesus. And to imitate Christ, we need to do the same thing. So we go to those who need you, and then here's the second thing, is to have faith beyond experience. Have faith beyond experience. Look at verse 39. It says, so Peter rose and went with them, and when he arrived, they took him to the upper room. All the widows stood beside him, weeping and showing tunics and other garments that Dorcas made while she was with them. She was amazing. But Peter put them all outside and knelt down and prayed. And turning to the body, he said, Tabitha, arise. She opened her eyes, and when she saw Peter, she sat up. Here we see Peter in a situation that he hasn't been in before, right? Peter's never raised anyone from the dead. He's seen Jesus do it, but he has never done this himself. And so Peter arrives in Joppa and is brought into this upper room, and he meets all the widows that Tabitha had blessed and cared for when she was alive. And then he kicks them all out of the upper room. Why does he do that? I don't know. I don't know why he kicks everyone out. Maybe he wasn't sure if this would work. I don't know. Maybe he just needed to be alone with God. We don't know the reason, but he does it. And then he kneels down and he prays and he says, Tabitha, arise. Peter here is demonstrating a faith beyond his own lived experience. He's doing something he's never done before. Have you ever been in a situation like that? Doing something that you've never done before? We do this in small ways all the time, right? We do this in small ways all the time. Like, I always get a number one at Chick-fil-A, okay? Always. But maybe this time I'll do something I've never done and get the spicy chicken sandwich. You know, I'll try it. See what happens. I'm going to go for it, right? Or like, I always go this way to work, but Google Maps is telling me to go this new way that I've never gone before and that it's going to be faster. And you're like, okay, I've never done that before. I've never gone that way, but you know what? I'm going to trust Google Maps and I'm going to go for it. And then you do. And you're late because it's never faster, right? It's, I don't know. It's never... Right, we do this every time we go to see a movie in a movie theater, right? We've never seen the movie, but we're like, you know what? I'm going to trust that it's good, and I'm going to trust that it's good enough for the money that I pay for it, and we go for it, right? We do it in small ways all the time. We also do this in more significant ways as well. First-time homebuyers, right? Never done that before, but I'm going to go for it, and I'm going to have faith that it's all going to work out, right? Or sending your kids out into the world after high school. Never done that before, but it's necessary for them, and I have faith that it's going to work out. What about asking the woman you love to marry you, right? Whew, never done that before. I'm sweaty, and I don't know. I hope she says yes, but I'm going to have faith, and I'm going to go for it, right? I'm going to hope it works out. Doing things that we've never done. We do this all the time, right? We do things that we've never done all the time in every area of our life. And so why is it so hard to do this in our faith? Why is it so hard to do things that we've never done in our faith? Stepping out and doing these things, like sharing your faith, for example. Did you know that 60 to 70% of Christians say they haven't shared the gospel with an unchurched person? 60 to 70%. So over half of Christians in America haven't done, quite honestly, one of the most basic things in the faith, which is to share their faith, to proclaim the gospel. Then you get to the individual level and you start having conversations with people and you find out that there are people and they say, I've never prayed out loud before. I've never prayed with another person before. I've never shared a Bible verse with someone. I've never asked God for healing. I've never led a Bible study. I've never served in the church. I've never served in the community. I've never gone on a mission trip. And the list goes on and on and on. And so many things in the faith not done. And I'm not judging or condemning if any of those are true of you. My heart in this is purely pastoral. Because I think that this is a thing that seriously holds us back. We don't have a faith in Christ that goes beyond our own lived experience. And when we don't, we are not going to be taking ground from the kingdom of darkness. We won't. We're going to get stuck doing the things that we've just always done. Never stepping out in faith. And here's the thing, is we have a God who raised Tabitha to life. We have a God who raised Aeneas off of the mat and cured him. We have a God who can do anything and everything. That's who we have faith in. So we don't need to be afraid of something like rejection. We don't need to fear not having all of the knowledge to do something. We don't need to fear not being eloquent in our speech. We don't need to fear the unknown result because our faith is in the God of the impossible. And we need to have a faith that goes beyond our lived experience, just like Peter. One thing that I do think was helpful for Peter, though, is that he saw Jesus do this exact thing in Mark 5. He saw him do this exact thing. He had someone that went before him and showed him that, one, it's possible, and two, here's how you do it, right? And isn't it just so remarkable how when someone shows you something, they show you that it's possible, or they show you how to do it, it can make fear disappear in your life. Have you noticed that? I think one of my favorite things that I used to do was something called Bibles, Burgers, and Blankets, which is a youth event that we do in downtown Chicago. And we take a bunch of our students from a bunch of our campuses and we go to downtown Chicago and we serve the homeless population there right around Thanksgiving time when it starts to get cold. And we bring them, it's really descriptive, Bibles, Burgers, and Blankets. But the blankets is warm clothes and mittens and shoes and jackets and all of these things, right? We try to bring as much as we can. And so we get off of the train in the city and we all gather together to pray together and to talk about it. And every time there's new students who come and they're so afraid. They're so nervous and anxious. They're like, I've never talked to a stranger before. I've never done this type of thing before. And so what happens is the first three encounters that we have, I like to do them. And so I will go and have these conversations. I'll pray for them. I'll share Christ with them, and I'll meet the needs that they have with whatever we have to give to them. And I'll do it for the first three. And we get all different sorts of interactions, responsive people, unresponsive people. And then after those three are done, we gather back up together and I say, all right, now I'm done, all right? And now it's your turn to go and to have these conversations and to share your faith and to pray and to give things to and serve these homeless people. And so the amazing thing is that they do. The people who are so afraid, they go out and they start having these conversations and they share their faith. And then you always have the one who's like really, really timid, who's always standing in the back and not speaking up yet. But as the day goes on and they see their friends stepping out and having these conversations and praying for these people, they then are like, okay, I've seen it done a lot now. Now I'm going to jump in, and they do it. And by the time the day is over, everyone is going forward. They're excited. I want to go and I want to share my faith with this person and pray with them and care for them. It's an incredible thing that happens every single year at this event because they have someone who is showing them. They've seen it done. And that removes some of the fear that they have. And I wonder what would happen if we brought more people around us while we were sharing Christ with others. Or if we brought people around us while we were praying or leading a Bible study or serving or whatever it is. How much of an encouragement might that be to someone who's never seen it done? How could we help other people live in faith outside of their own experience? Here's the last thing. Do exactly what Jesus did. Do exactly what Jesus did. Peter does in these moments exactly what Jesus did. He didn't make it up. He didn't go with the flow. He didn't wing it. As a faithful disciple, Peter did exactly what he saw his master do. He just followed his example. He just imitated exactly what he saw. In fact, let me show you. Look at verse 34. It says, and Peter said to him, Aeneas, Jesus Christ heals you. Rise and make your bed. And immediately he rose, and all the residents of Lydda and Sharon saw him, and they turned to the Lord. Now, Peter added something here, right? He says, Jesus Christ heals you. Now, we know that Jesus didn't speak in the third person, right, in the Gospels. He wasn't like, Jesus Christ heals you, right? He didn't do that. Peter added that part, but it's because he's pointing to his master. He's pointing to Jesus. He's saying, listen, the power that's about to happen is not coming from me, Peter. It's coming from Jesus Christ. He's pointing out that the power is of Jesus, not of himself. And that is a really important truth for us as we go along life and ministry, is that we do it by the power of Jesus, not by the power of ourselves. Thank God for that, right? But when Peter says, rise and make your bed, he's doing what Jesus did. He's saying what Jesus said. He is doing what he saw Jesus do, right? At the pool of Bethesda, the paralytic man who was there for many, many years. In John chapter 5, verse 8, Jesus said to this paralytic man, get up, take up your bed, and walk. And at once the man was healed, and he took up his bed and he walked. How about at Peter's own house in Capernaum, when the four friends lowered their paralytic friend down through the roof? In Matthew 9, 6, he said to the paralytic, rise, pick up your bed, and go home. Peter is using the same language that Jesus used. He's doing what he saw Jesus do. It's why he says to this man, arise, make your bed. He does it also with Tabitha. in even a more precise way. Look at verse 40. They're in the upper room, and Peter says, but Peter put them all outside, and he knelt down and he prayed. And turning to the body, he said, "Tabitha, arise." And she opened her eyes, and when she saw Peter, she sat up, and he gave her his hand and raised her up. Then calling the saints and widows, he presented her alive, and it became known throughout all Joppa, and many believed in the Lord. See the multiplication happening here? Because Peter is imitating Christ. He stayed in Joppa for many days with one Simon, a tanner. Again, Peter is doing exactly what Jesus did, with even more precision this time. Because in Mark chapter 5, verses 40 through 41, this is Jairus' daughter. Remember the story? She dies, and Jesus goes to the house, and he goes up into the upper room. And then it says this, "But he put them all outside, and he took the child's father and her mother and those who were with him." Who was with him? Peter, James, and John. So Peter was in the room where Jesus did this miracle. He was in the room where it happened. And Jesus went in where the child was, and taking her by the hand, he said to her, "Talitha kumi," which means, "Little girl, I say to you, arise." Some of you are already seeing it. But look at the exactness of what Peter says and what Jesus says in this passage. And I think that this is really, I think Luke is trying to get us to see this in this passage, because what he does is he does something kind of unique, is that he gives the Aramaic translation of Dorcas' name. Dorcas is the Greek. Tabitha is the Aramaic translation of her name. It's the same language that Jesus spoke. It's the same language that Peter spoke. And here's why I think he does it. Because in Aramaic, Jesus says to the little girl, Jairus' daughter, he says, "Talitha kumi." And Peter in Aramaic, when he says this, he says, "Tabitha kumi." Look at the exactness. Look at the mirror of what's happening here. The difference between what Jesus said and what Peter said is one letter. One letter. It's almost a direct mirror. Peter is doing exactly what Jesus did. Isn't that amazing? He's just doing exactly what Jesus did. He's imitating his master. It's simple. He's just doing what he had been shown. He's just doing what Jesus did, how he did it. We, however, tend to complicate things, don't we? I need the newest book or podcast to tell me how to act as a Christian. I need the newest edition of systematic theology to fill my mind. I need the newest worship song to fill and fuel my faith. I need the next experience to keep going. I need to learn the new culture that's here so I can be more effective. I need the bracelet, WWJD, to remind me to think philosophically of what Jesus would do. I'm not bashing the bracelet, by the way. All of these things actually are amazing things. They're incredible things. They're great, right? But what if we just broke it down to the basics first? What if we just broke it down, and what if we fell in love with the Gospels and we looked at the life and ministry of Jesus Christ? What if we just did what he did? What if we just said what he said? What if we just did what he said to do? What if we just imitated exactly what Jesus did? And here's the thing, is we don't have to wonder about what Jesus did or what Jesus said. We don't have to wonder. It's all right here. Now, certainly, there are going to be, Jesus didn't go through every situation or circumstance that you have gone through or will go through, right? And that's what these other amazing resources are for. They're there to help with that, right? But to be additive. Key word, additive. And we can't make those additive things the whole thing. We can't make them the whole thing. We need to seek first to imitate Jesus, to do what he did, to say what he said, to do what he said. And then we can start adding all of those other things on top of that, like the bracelets and the books and the podcasts and the songs and the everything else to help us in our Christian life. Peter was imitating Christ. And because he was imitating Christ, we see multiplication, right? Many people in Lydda and the surrounding area of Sharon, the plains of Sharon, they came to know Christ. Many people in Joppa believed in Jesus. The kingdom of God was multiplying and it was breaking through into the kingdom of this age. And I wonder what would happen if we did the same thing. The same simple thing that Peter did, which was to imitate his master, to do what he did. I wonder what would happen if we did that. If by imitating Christ, we would also see multiplication happen. Could we see the kingdom of God breaking through into the kingdom of this age here in Crystal Lake, here in the surrounding cities? I hope that we do. Let's pray. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you for the examples that you place before us. And God, I just pray that you help us with this, Lord. We can't do this on our own. We need the help of the Holy Spirit constantly. And even though this is a simple truth of imitating you and doing what you did and doing what you said and saying what you said, even though that's simple, it doesn't make it easy. We are faced with hard situations, hard decisions every single day. And so, Lord, we just pray for your wisdom. Pray for your guidance, Lord. Would we seek to find you in your word? Would we seek to continue to fall in love with the gospels? To never get tired of reading how Jesus lived and how he did ministry and how he met the needs of others and how he served people so well. And Lord, would we continually be transformed into the image of your Son, Jesus Christ? Would you help us in that this week as we go out into a week of Thanksgiving? Lord, would we take this opportunity to share our faith, to step outside, to have faith that goes beyond our experience as family comes in, as friends come in this week? Would you use us as your kingdom to break through into the kingdom of this present age, Lord? Would we see multiplication? Would you help us to imitate your Son, Jesus? We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.